Big Things Come in Small Packages by Eleanora E. Tate. Background. Eleanora E. Tate was born in Canton, Missouri, and spent her first year of school in a one-room schoolhouse for students in the first through eighth grades. She wrote her first story when she was in the third grade. Tate says she writes books and stories so that all people can read about the proud history and culture of African Americans. I want to tell you about a boy I knew who lived in Moorhead City, North Carolina, some years ago named Tucker Willis. He lived by Calico Creek, where it narrows down to marsh grass, flounder, and fiddler crabs. It's not far from the backside of the Moorhead City Port Terminal, where the big ships come in from the Atlantic Ocean. Everybody liked him, and he was good at almost everything he put his hands to. But when Tucker turned 11 or 12, he was still so short, he looked like an elf. And you know how it is when you're a little different from other folks, in even some harmless kind of way. Kids called him Tom Thumb, Squirt, Midget, Inchworm, Dwarf. I thought Tucker was the cutest little thing in the world. But to him, back then, I was old knock-kneed Lashana May, the girl who lived down the street. I was a couple years younger than him. We were friends, though, and went to the same church, St. Luke's Missionary Baptist, and the same school. Back in those days, in the 1970s, young boys and girls didn't hang out as boyfriend and girlfriend like kids do now. Plus, I was just a skinny girl with braids and braces. Kids called me wires because of those braces, and boy, did it ever make me mad. So Tucker and I had a lot in common, and lots of times we talked about the things kids called us, especially when we went fishing. Even though being called those names hurt, Tucker gave up fighting the kids who said them. Fighting didn't help. The name callers were all too big for him to beat up. So after a while, he learned to ignore the teasing. Most times he laughed it off. He was a tough little dude, but oh mercy, how he hated those names. One day, Tucker did something that made everybody stop calling him names he didn't like. I think it helped him grow a few inches too. You need to know a few things about this boy before I tell you what changed things around. Tucker could do almost anything that any other kid his age could do. He was a hotshot shortstop on the Little League baseball team. He could jump like a flea on the basketball court. He was smart in school. He was in the Boy Scouts. He could swim like a fish and even surf. He looked like a Tootsie Roll to me in that big ocean. Yeah, I had a name for him too. I called him Tootsie Roll, but never to his face. I just kept it to myself. And when I called him that in my head, I didn't mean it in a bad way. Tucker could do some fishing. He especially liked to fish his folks' little pier out alongside their house. In the summertime, he'd lie on his stomach on the pier and catch some of the biggest flounder to come out of Calico Creek. Instead of a rod and reel, he used a handful of fishing line, a hook baited with shrimp, and a sinker to keep the bait from floating on the surface. He'd dangle that shrimp an inch or two off the bottom, right in front of a flounder's nose. Sometimes we'd fish together on his pier, and I wouldn't catch diddly squat. Not even a pinfish, not even a lizard fish, nothing. But old Tootsie Roll could catch him. I tried fishing the way he did, but most of the time I used a rod and reel because I thought the way Tucker did it was country. I still couldn't catch anything, not in Calico Creek. I did all right when I fished at the pier in Atlantic Beach. That's how I'd see Tucker surfing. He even got teased about surfing because not many black kids we knew surfed. Shoot, as much as we all loved the water, not a whole lot of us even knew how to swim. I didn't. Not until Tucker taught me later on. He and his dad or mom would fish out of their own little pier all night sometimes with a Coleman lantern for light. His folks used regular rods and reels. I never fished out there at night with them because the mosquitoes and the gnats would about eat me up. Plus, my mama liked to tell me that they used to do baptizing in that creek, which was okay. But then mama'd say, Lashana May, you watch out being around that creek by yourself at night. The people who got baptized there and who've passed on come back to that creek as spirits in the middle of the night when the moon's full. They'll be singing and celebrating and shouting and praising, and they don't want to be disturbed unless you want to join in with them. Me being a scared little kid, you can believe that Mama didn't have to worry about me going out to nobody's Calico Creek by myself at night. But sometimes I'd go to my window at night and look out to see if anybody was celebrating the way she said. All I ever saw were grown folks fishing. Sometimes, somebody would holler when they caught a big one. After I got grown, I understood that Mama told me that story to try and help me stay out of trouble. She was worried I'd drown or get into some kind of foolishness. Well, it worked. I knew that it was easy to get into trouble when you're out someplace where you're not supposed to be. Anyway, what happened to change all the name-calling started when Tucker was on his pier trying to catch a flounder. He noticed a man standing on the Moton Motel dock just a few yards from him. The man had a thick white mustache and a Van Dyke beard and wore a blue and gold military-style jacket and cap. I wasn't there, so I didn't see him, but that's what Tucker told me. When the man waved, Tucker, being a friendly kind of kid, waved back. They struck up a conversation. The man said his name was Richard and that he was staying at the motel for a few days. His home was in Manteo on Roanoke Island, not far from the Outer Banks, where he worked with the U.S. Life Saving Service. Tucker figured what he meant was that he was with the U.S. Coast Guard. Tucker was pretty knowledgeable about the Coast Guard, but he had never heard of this Life Saving Service. Tucker asked the man if he liked to fish. Richard said yes. He'd been a commercial fisherman before he became a captain in the life-saving service. As a lifesaver, he said, he and his men went into the ocean in the middle of hurricanes and nor'easters to save passengers and crew members whose ships were sinking. Of course, anything about water fascinated Tucker, so he must have asked Richard a million questions. Richard didn't seem to mind, though. He said he didn't get to talk kids much anymore. Richard said a good crewman had to be strong, an excellent swimmer, quick thinker, and in good physical health, have good eyesight, and understand how dangerous the sea can be. He told so many stories about life-saving that Tucker wished he could enlist right away, and said so. He had the right qualifications, other than being too young, of course, and too short. Richard told him it wasn't the size of a person that got the job done, it was how bad the person wanted to do it. How were those huge ships, two and more stories high, able to move into the Morehead City port and back out to sea? Most couldn't do it without little tugboats pushing and pulling them in, Richard said. A tugboat could bring in a ship many times its size. Richard said that Tucker would make a good tugboat, and one day might even grow to be a big ship. He thanked Tucker for the conversation and said maybe they'd meet again, and then the man wandered off back toward the motel. Tucker said for the rest of the afternoon he thought over what Richard had said. A few days later, Tucker decided to go with his dad to the Atlantic Beach pier to fish. His daddy worked there as a cook. For some reason, I couldn't go that day. I've always wished I had. Tucker said he took his surfboard, too, in case fishing got slow. It was early morning, but a hot July wind blew in from the southwest, making the waves choppy and sandy. The tide was going out. Hardly anybody was on the pier, which was another hint that the fish might not be biting. Tucker said one guy was in the water, floating on a red raft like a huge jellyfish. After a good hour had passed and he hadn't gotten a bite, Tucker left his rod and reel with his father in the pier restaurant's kitchen and went surfing. After he swam out far enough, he climbed onto his surfboard and rode a wave in. When he glanced back at the pier, guess who he saw? His new friend, Richard, on the pier, clapping for him. At least this time he had on shorts and a regular shirt. Tucker said he bet Richard had about burnt up in that heavy uniform the other day. Richard hollered, "Do it, tugboat! Pull that old wave in!" "Tugboat," Richard Tucker said as he frowned until he remembered Richard's story about tugboats. So he waved back and swam out to pull in another one, passing the man in on the raft. The man said, "You're kind of little to be way out here, ain't you, Squirt?" Tucker just shook his head and kept going. Tucker pulled in four more waves until he noticed a tall purple thunderhead rising up on the southwest horizon. That cloud meant a storm was probably on its way, but Tucker figured he had at least half an hour before the wind kicked up the waves and blew the cloud in and the rain began. Tucker wasn't afraid of a thing, but his common sense and his folks had told him to always leave away from water when storms and lightning came along. It's hard to get grown without having common sense, because being stupid can get you killed sometimes. Keeping an eye on the horizon, Tucker went on pulling in those waves until a huge one arced up behind his back and crashed down on him. Tucker disappeared. Wipeout. No big deal for Tucker, though. He popped right up in the water and grabbed his board, which was tied to his ankle. He was all right, but the man on the raft wasn't. He thrashed around in the water screaming that he couldn't swim. As that big black cloud spread across the sky toward them, the wind and waves grew rougher. Wanting to help the man, but concerned about his own safety, Tucker hesitated, then straddled a surfboard and, using his hands for oars, paddled toward the raft. He'd have time to get the guy's raft back to him and then head in. But as Tucker passed, the man lunged at the surfboard, knocking Tucker off. And then this guy grabbed hold of Tucker. Wrapped up in that big bear's arms and legs with the sea getting choppier, Tucker said he knew he was about to die. He began to pray. But something lifted Tucker up through the water and onto his surfboard, where he was able to catch his breath. That's when he saw his friend Richard in the water, too. Have mercy. Richard was hauling that raft toward the man. With two big heaves, Richard snatched that guy straight up out of the water and onto the raft. Richard yelled, "Let's push and pull it, tugboat. Push and pull it in." Somehow, Tucker and Richard pushed and pulled that raft, with the guy glued to it, close enough to the shore that the man was able to wade in the rest of the way. Four or five people splashed into the water and helped them onto the beach and into the pier house. One of the helpers was a reporter on vacation. As soon as everybody was inside the pier house, the rain poured down. An arrow of lightning whizzed across the pier into the water and lit up the whole ocean. That's when Tucker said he got scared seeing that lightning. He'd have been fried alive, you know. The guy Tucker rescued was named Nibbles. Mr. Nibbles was so grateful, he gave Tucker $100 right on the spot. The reporter interviewed everybody and took pictures of Tucker, Nibbles, and Tucker's dad, who almost had a heart attack when he heard what happened. When the reporter asked how such a small boy was able to rescue a big grown man, Tucker said, "'Cause I'm a tugboat, like Richard said. We pulled big ones in." But when Tucker turned around to point out Richard, he couldn't find him. The reporter's story about Tucker's rescue is in the local paper, then got picked up by the Associated Press and went all over the world. CBS TV even flew him and his folks to New York to be on its morning show. Afterwards, back home in Moorhead City, strangers stopped Tucker on the street, in stores, even came to his home. They wanted to see the little tugboat that had hauled in that big man and get his autograph. Businesses up and down Arundel Street put up "Welcome Home, Tugboat" posters in their windows. And there was a parade. Tucker was a hero. He and the mayor rode on the back of a big old white Cadillac convertible and waved at everybody. I was so proud that I almost forgot and hollered out, "Way to go, Tootsie Roll," but I caught myself in time. Everybody, even local folks, called Tucker Tugboat after that, including us kids. We'd never seen a real-life hero close up before, especially one our age. It wasn't cool anymore to tease him with those other names. Funny how things can turn right around, isn't it? And you know what? Tucker grew to be 6'5". He played on the North Carolina Central University Eagles basketball team, joined the U.S. Coast Guard, and lives in Kill Devil Hills, North Carolina, on the Outer Banks. But there's something Tucker never figured out. When he first told people that Richard was the real hero, nobody believed him. Apparently, nobody but Tucker had seen Richard. Not even Mr. Nibbles. There's more. When Tucker went into the pier gift shop to spend some of his rescue money, he picked up a book about the Coast Guard. He was thumbing through it when he stopped at an old-timey picture of some black men wearing jackets like Richard's. They were standing in front of a building on the Outer Banks. Below it was a picture of, yes, Richard. Mustache, beard, jacket, everything. Tucker read, "History of the Pea Island Life-Saving Service. Captain Richard Etheridge was keeper of the Pea Island Life-Saving Service, a forerunner of part of what is now the U.S. Coast Guard. This unique, all-African-American, courageous, life-saving crew, and those who followed, saved hundreds of shipwrecked passengers' lives by plunging into the stormy seas and bringing their charges back to safety." Tucker said he shot out of that gift shop toward the restaurant to show his dad the book to prove his case, but what he read next made him stop. Captain Etheridge, born in 1844 on Roanoke Island in North Carolina, died in 1900. Tucker said he read that date 15 or 20 times before it started to sink in. 1900? Richard Etheridge had been dead for almost 100 years. How is it possible a dead man helped him save that guy? Unless Richard was a ghost. He'd been talking to and swimming with a ghost? You can believe Tucker hit up the library that very next day and searched for as much information as he could find on Richard Etheridge. There wasn't much, but what he read was that Richard Etheridge was all those great things he had read about and that he still died in 1900. A few years later, when Tucker's folks visited the North Carolina Aquarium on Roanoke Island, Tucker found Richard Etheridge's grave and monument. Etheridge's headstone was marked 1844 to 1900. That's when Tucker stopped talking about Richard being involved in the rescue. Unless somebody asked. So now, if you run into Tucker, Tugboat Willis, ask him about the rescue, and he'll tell you. Then, real carefully, ask if he ever met Richard Etheridge. He'll tell you yes, he did, and what he learned. What he learned was that it pays to be polite to everybody you meet, like Tucker was to a man named Richard. You never know when that person might help you. And every time Tucker tells me the story, he tells it to me the same way I told you. Seeing how Tucker turned out proves that some mighty things that help folks out in some mighty big ways can come in some mighty small packages. It also proves the good things come to those who wait, like I did. I know, because I'm Mrs. LaShawna Mae Willis, Tugboat's wife. There really was a man named Richard Etheridge, a professional fisherman who was born in 1844 on Roanoke Island off North Carolina. A member of the 36th U.S. Colored Troops of the Union Army, he fought at the Battle of New Market Heights in Virginia during the Civil War. And in 1880, Etheridge was hired as the keeper of the Pea Island Life-Saving Station on the Barrier Islands, the Outer Banks of North Carolina. The station continued to set a high standard of performance with its all-black personnel until 1947, when the Coast Guard closed down the facilities. No one made any formal recognition of the Pea Island surfsmen daring rescues until 1996. In March of that year, Etheridge and his men were finally acknowledged posthumously in formal ceremonies in Washington, D.C., with a gold life-saving medal from the United States Coast Guard. Etheridge and his wife and daughter are buried on the grounds of the North Carolina Aquarium in Manteo, which maintains an exhibit on these brave men.